Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's 1945, the Hollywood Studios year by year. We begin, as always, with Paramount. We will be discussing The Man in Half Moon Street and Salty O'Rourke. And as always, before we get into the films themselves, let's hear from Joel W. Findler. His book, The Hollywood Story, has these amazing pink charts that give us not a complete but a reasonable picture of the roster of stars at each studio during a given year. Findler gives each person a 1, 2, or 3 star rating depending on his subjective opinion of how important this star was to the studio during the length of their contract. For Paramount, we've got Veronica Lake, 2 stars, Betty Hutton, 3 stars. Alan Ladd, 3 stars. Barry Fitzgerald, 2 stars. Bing Crosby, 3 stars. Ray Milland, 3 stars.
Who knew Barry Fitzgerald was that important?
Well, he was, because of Going My Way and Derivatives. We've lost Fred McMurray. He drops off after 1944. Dorothy L'Amour, 2 stars. Bob Hope, 3 stars. Barbara Stanwyck, back for a little stint, 3 stars. And Paulette Goddard, 3 stars. Now for our regular check-in with the Paramount story. This is written by John Douglas Eames. This is another one, unfortunately, that does not have a synopsis for the studio that year. There's only going to be a couple of these that actually do take the trouble to tell us how the studio was doing. We will welcome those when they pop up. Sadly, The Man in Half Moon Street got a very perfunctory one-sentence review in here. It's relegated to the little box at the end of the chapter that said, well, these ones also got made. I think it's been very hard to see historically.
The TCM notes say print that was viewed by whoever wrote them was missing a reel.
Well, I feel like what we saw seemed complete.
There were some abrupt transitions, though.
There were. It looked good, though, actually. It
looked okay, yeah.
It was in better shape than the print that we saw of Salty O'Rourke.
True.
Let's hear, for better or for worse, what John Douglas Eames had to say. A young-looking scientist, actually ancient, resorts to killing young men for the glandular extract he needs. We do get a short cast list. Nils Asther, Helen Walker, and Paul Cavanaugh, that's it. Director, Ralph Murphy. Producer, Walter McEwen.
Ancient is relative here. He's supposed to be 90.
True, he's not a 1,000-year-old vampire.
Although he does get called a mummy, memorably, at one point.
He does. It's not a great description of what we actually see in the film. It's not inaccurate because we do find out by the end that he has been killing a young man every decade in order to further his project.
I didn't think the deaths were intentional, though.
No.
I thought that they were trying to keep the subjects alive.
They are, but it hasn't worked yet. That's why he's a serial killer on file, right? They match up his fingerprints with this unsolved mystery that's been going for 60 years that they've been trying to figure out.
It's very odd that this character is presented so sympathetically.
Before we meet the man in Half Moon Street, we get 3 different people giving their opinions of what he is, culminating with Helen Walker saying, you know, he's one of the greatest geniuses of all time.
So we should comment on the casting. Nils Asther is carrying this entire movie on his shoulders. You can make the comparison between studios by comparing this to one that we recently watched for Universal, the Mad Doctor of Market Street, who was also trying to achieve immortality of a sort and accidentally killing people in all of his experiments.
True, he was a lot more cavalier about it, I would say. And he was doing it more than just once every decade.
I guess that makes a difference, frequency. Well, that movie was comedic. The Doctor was definitely presented in a negative light throughout. However, we did comment when we were discussing it. It seems like he has a good idea, really, and maybe people should be showing him a little more respect.
Well, yeah, the people that opposed him came off as intellectual dead ends as well, as far as I recall. And that's similar to this film, but it is a different angle of vision. I mean, he's the protagonist, which I don't think you could really say about the Mad Doctor of Market Street.
No, he's the antagonist. So Nils Asther, he was not the first choice for this movie. Nils Asther at this point in his career is never the first choice. Actually, it was supposed to be a vehicle for Alan Ladd, but I think he was in the war at the time.
Or in Salty O'Rourke. Well, I'm very happy that they chose Nils Asther for this movie because he was great in it.
But I was going to say, he's 48 years old in this movie, and he doesn't look a day over the 35 that his character claims to be.
It's true. We know him best as General Yen.
This might be only the third movie I've seen him in, and it confirms, other than the Orientalist makeup, he didn't change anything at all for his performance as General Yen. Same accent, which is Swedish, but somehow works for this cultured, educated, multilingual general, warlord.
Here he's supposed to be vaguely from the continent somewhere. He's not English.
And his smooth continental manner is similar, and vaguely sinister air and charm are all similar in both movies.
He's structurally a villain, ultimately, in both movies, I suppose, but extremely sympathetic both times.
And tragic.
Exactly.
He's probably the most beautiful man I have ever seen.
Big words from Elise.
I just couldn't stop staring at him. The whole movie. He was gay, sadly for me, although he's dead anyway. He did try to romance Greta Garbo and was not the last gay man to do so.
Well, what's he been doing since General Yen, which is 1933?
Right. Well, his Wikipedia page says that between 1935 and 1940, he was forced to work in England after an alleged breach of contract led to a studio-based blacklist. He made 6 films there. He returned to Hollywood in 1940, and although he made another 19 films up until 1949, his career was never the same, and he appeared mostly in small supporting roles. Well, not this time. And since this was supposed to be an Alan Ladd vehicle, it must have been an A-picture.
Well, I don't think it was by the time we saw it, because the only people in it that we know at all are Nils Asther and Helen Walker. Everyone else is. They're good.
Helen Walker was in everything.
Helen Walker rules. You know about her tragic career arc. 1946 kind of was the apex, and she has a terrible drunk driving accident. She appears to have killed someone and nearly killed herself and some other people.
So, for that matter, did Gail Russell. And in Helen Walker's Wikipedia page, she is accused of being responsible for Gail Russell's alcoholism, but apparently there were many origin stories for that because a different one gets told on Gail Russell's Wikipedia page.
Our leading ladies for the films this week, these are two of the most incredible, at least in potential, stars of the 40s that just got derailed.
Gail Russell drank herself to death by age 36.
I know. Yeah, I've been sad about that since I was a teenager and I learned about it. But yeah, Helen Walker, she's not as pitiable because she's not drinking out of pure terror of being presented on the screen like Gail Russell. But she's amazing. And she's most famous these days for Nightmare Alley, playing the woman who just totally eats Tyrone Power up.
A lot of people didn't live very long who appear in these movies, including Alan Ladd, who only lived to be 51.
Yeah, I know.
Accidentally overdosed on alcohol and sedatives because of insomnia.
Terrible.
Nils Asther, on the other hand, lived to be 84, and when he retired from making films, devoted himself to painting.
Awesome.
Much like the secondary career of the man in Half Moon Street.
Right. David Manners did that too. So, Man in Half Moon Street.
Yes, at least according to Ladd's Wikipedia page. When he was in the armed services, a number of films that had been announced for him were postponed and or made with different actors, including Incendiary Blonde, The Story of Dr. Wassel, Ministry of Fear, and The Man in Half Moon Street.
Wow. Ministry of Fear is a great Fritz Lang movie with Ray Milland in it. I could see Alan Ladd in that one.
Can you see Alan Ladd in this one? Mad genius scientist?
Well, he's deceptively amazing, Alan Ladd. I've already gone on record with that along with our friend Simon.
It would have gone completely against the type he'd established.
Yeah, it would have been different. It would have been a different look for Alan Ladd, for sure. I think he could have done it, but no, I'm happy that it's Nils Asther. I think this is a really unique film experience. I had no idea what to expect. We just picked it because of the two stars. jars. I was thinking it would be a film noir.
No, it's a supernatural-ish gothic film.
The title vaguely recalls, well, at least to me, the Dashiell Hammett story, The House in Turk Street. It's just the inn street. But that's what I was expecting. I wasn't counting on seeing an immortality narrative and a kind of Frankenstein story.
No, we weren't sure even what the story was going to be for a little while. We were debating that, but the first sign that all is not normal is when Helen Walker is introducing him around at this dinner party being thrown in her father's house.
And there's an old relative or friend of the family, Minerva, who was a libertine in her youth, and she remarks that Nils Asther looks exactly like a man she had a romance with like 50 years ago. His reaction is incredible. As soon as that happens, you know you're in for a great movie. He doesn't demur. He doesn't say, oh, that's a weird coincidence. He actually just doubles down.
He started playing with her by recalling details of their affair.
Yeah, he narrates their sexual encounter, which in her mind had never been shared with anyone. And he's like, you know, grandfather luxuriated in giving all these details. She's like, oh my God. Although she's still enraptured with him. She's not angry.
She seems to enjoy the walk down memory lane.
Yeah, and it's actually him. Those two people had an affair in the 19th century.
At that point, though, I was wondering, is this going to be a time travel movie?
It certainly could have been. But when he gets home, he gets out his big book that says Vita Immortalis, and then you know.
You gotta hope no one's gonna snoop around when your records of your illicit experiments for over a century, or almost a century, just have the secret emblazoned on the front of the journal.
Yeah, well, he's got privacy in his mansion. So he's a doctor and painter. Although he doesn't break out the paintbrush very often, it seems, because it's not like the galleries of Europe are littered with his paintings. There's one that was hanging in Germany,
which is identical, almost, to this one. There is no explanation ever offered for that, and you just have to assume that Helen Walker was his ideal, like in The Young Girls of Rochefort.
Yeah, well, that's a very common trope.
The young idealist painter has painted Catherine Deneuve before he's seen her.
Right, so he seems to be genuinely in love with her. He is not playing tricks on her or anything like that. He's not trying to get anything out of her. This is, at long last it seems, a real affair of the heart for him. So we catch him at a very strange moment in his 9-decade existence. He's also coming to the end of a period. We don't know this exactly at the beginning, but as things develop, we learn that basically every 10 years, he needs another gland transplant. Otherwise, he's starting to get shaky. You know, at the end of the movie, we learn that if he doesn't get it in time, he's just going to turn into a full-blown old man.
Well, we kind of know that the whole way along, but that's what he's staving off with the help of some kind of glowing medicine that is very, very dangerous and could kill him.
A stopgap, yeah, that they've developed. Like, if you can't get the glandular extract in time, you can drink this for a little while.
That's like Tylenol. If you take it for too long, your liver's shot or something worse.
He endures this party. Everyone is astonished by his artistry, and then he ducks out because he's got a phone call. There's a cable from Cairo. His partner in crime, his accomplice, is on his way, and he's already told Helen Walker he won't see her for a few weeks because he's going to be in the laboratory conducting an experiment that may be of great benefit to mankind.
It's Dr. Kurt Van Breuken, played by Reinhold Schunzel.
So we have no idea what this guy's going to be like. We just know him through cables for a while. But when he arrives, he's an elderly man, and we learn that Nils Asther was the bold one. He experimented on himself with the aid of his friend. The other guy just elected to age normally and just help with these periodic surgical experiments that always have gone awry for the source of the transplant. I think the whole movie is really well shot.
The whole London foggy sequence, are you thinking of? Where he rescues the young medical student?
Yeah, there's definitely a vibe that they're trying to give off, I think, that circumvents the Hays Code. I mean, he's stalking this guy, and it feels a bit like...
Well, it's somewhere between Dracula picking off a prostitute and some kind of homosexual...
Yeah, like really, cruising.
Really creepy homosexual seduction.
Exactly. When the policeman looks down, he sees these men. You could tell that he wants to arrest them. That's why he's chasing them.
What's going on down there? Yeah, because I couldn't... It's just a guy rescuing a guy from committing suicide. I couldn't understand why the policeman was so interested.
Well, this is Britain, and it was the same in America. America, and maybe even worse in some states. But yeah, you'd be arrested.
So it feels like the whole thing adapts itself very well, this film, to the casting of Nils Asther.
Yeah, and I'm sure he relished it. Once he gets the guy home, they have a big long talk. This young student, I mean, he's really freaked out by Nils Asther because he's seen him before many times at gambling dens. He's been stalked all across London by him.
Talking about Nils Asther spending a lot of time staring at him.
So it turns out, you know, he's trying to kill himself because he's gotten himself into huge debt. It's going to be a disgrace for the family. And Asther is like, well, that's not going to help with the family disgrace, throwing yourself in the Thames. How about you participate in this big experiment and I'll pay off your debts and more?
By the way, the cinematographer, like the director, just did all sorts of things.
The director, I know he did I Want a Divorce, but I don't really have any kind of a sense of who he is.
That's as good as you're going to get based on our film knowledge. But the cinematographer did shoot Ministry of Fear.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a cool one. So he's got the noir chops. The movie really does bring that in those scenes. But then it's got all these drawing room scenes too. Very interesting B movie. The student, he's very wary of this whole thing, as he should be, but when he hears that Van Breuken is involved, it changes things for him. This is a world famous endocrinologist. He knows details about this guy. He knows the kinds of theories he's advanced, and he's quite interested in participating. Nevertheless, Nils Asther doesn't take any chances and keeps this guy drugged and locked in a room. It really is quite a feat of cognitive dissonance, because we like this guy, we like Nils Asther, and we're trying to believe that he's got the best intentions ultimately, but it's pretty hard when you see what he's doing, and it really makes you fight yourself, this movie, as you watch it, I find.
Well, he is, Helen Walker sticks up for him as some kind of genius. I don't know where she gets that impression, other than just talking to him, because nobody seems to know who he is, as I guess they wouldn't, because whoever he was is dead as far as anybody's concerned now.
Well, he's using the same name, right? That's why Minerva knows him.
But he doesn't seem to have a reputation of his own, because everyone just keeps talking about Van Breuken.
He hasn't been in London that long. They said 5 years. Eventually, this goes to Scotland Yard. Those scenes are pretty fun, actually.
But she has defended him as this visionary, both to the audience at the beginning of the movie and to her father.
They liken him to Da Vinci, and the way that that scans is that he is a medical doctor and scientist who has some reputation, at least, and also an artist.
Right. So what we're seeing here, which Nils Asther is the right performer to convey without too much campy or any campy exaggeration, he can just give off this aroma naturally, is a man who, as Van Breuken keeps accusing him, has gone from wanting to do this research to benefit mankind to just wanting to keep himself alive and forever young. But we're also seeing someone who, so he's an addict, but he's also just unhinged in the pursuit of his creative science in itself, you know, to the point of being inhuman. So I think where the audience sympathy lies, or the tightrope it's walking, is that on the one hand, you can identify with him because anyone in his position would also want to maintain this situation. And on the other hand, he's kind of beyond us, otherworldly, and doesn't play by our rules.
It's also important that he's kind of lying to himself, and the fact that he's doing that enables us to lie to ourselves about how much reckless disregard for human life he actually has. Until he starts getting into it with Van Breuken, and the doctor keeps saying, you know, that boy that you've got imprisoned upstairs is dying from all of these drugs you're plying him with to get him ready for the surgery. Nils Asther is like, no, no, don't be silly. He's fine.
We're just going to slow him down a little.
Well, yeah, exactly.
That's what he says. Keep him from getting too hysterical. That's what he is implying.
Interesting echo of Killers of the Flower Moon, which we saw last week. He would have been totally safe and able to continue his experiments, able to continue his quest for immortality unimpeded without this great love that he's developed for Helen Walker, because that's the source of all of his troubles. He's a complete outsider in these social circles. Helen Walker was being courted by a dull doctor that she's not interested in, but this guy is really pissed off, on the alert, looking for any kind of dirt he can gather up on Nils Asther, and lucky for him, there's a lot.
Right, and he finds this out by accident because Nils Asther finds out that Van Breuken is too old and ill to be able to do these surgeries any longer.
He's had a stroke, so he can't do the fine work of the surgery. He's able to theorize and think along with Nils Asther, but someone else is going to have to do the manual labor.
He goes in search of a discredited doctor who'd be willing to work with them. And this is how the rejected pseudo-doctor finds out that there's something suspicious about this guy.
Yeah, and he goes straight to Helen Walker's dad, and the two of them go to Scotland Yard.
There's some good comedy with these two, trying to trip up Dr. Julian Carell.
I like all of the actors in this movie. I just don't know them very well, or at all in most cases. I'm not sure who played the dad.
Sir Humphrey Brandon? Edmund Brion.
He was really good. And the inspector was excellent as well. When they show up at Scotland Yard, he's like, well, I know you're a very important member of the gentry or the aristocracy. I'd like to help you, but this man hasn't committed any crimes. Just the fact that you don't want him to marry your daughter is no business of Scotland Yard's. And...
but they're willing to check his fingerprints anyway.
He's like, okay, well, you bring me the fingerprints, I guess I'll run them through our system if you can do it, but we're not going to send the police to get them or anything like that.
My favorite scene about all this plotting against Nils Asther's character is when they're taking her portrait to Scotland Yard, and
I know.
And Helen Walker just happens to walk in while this is happening, and the father is literally like, I was hoping she wouldn't be here for this.
Yeah, it was great. And Helen Walker is so impressive in every scene.
Completely tells him off and tells him they're crazy, and they are acting crazy, but we happen to know that it's all real.
You don't like my boyfriend, you're sending his artwork to Scotland Yard for analysis. What the hell is wrong with you, Dad?
She gets really angry in this
yeah,
scene.
Yeah, well, with good reason.
Yeah, these two are doing a lot of interference. Now, I happen to be the type who, when I watched Dracula movies when I was a kid, and I still pretty much feel that way, watching them now as an adult. Of course, this is how you're supposed to feel. I'd get really mad at the people who are persecuting Dracula and trying to fuck up his immortal life thing and his romantic plans with the women in the picture. And I certainly felt that, you know, even more so in this movie, where there are less obvious signs that Nils Asther is the devil.
Were you rationalizing? That boy threw himself in the river anyway.
So yes, of course.
He should be dead.
Of course. Like, what? He hasn't lost anything by this. Right? And, I mean, presumably their other subjects were acquired in similar ways.
He prowled the streets looking for...
somebody who doesn't care whether they live or die, and might get lucky and make some money off of this, but never do.
No one ever does, no.
But yeah, so he never plays this character as evil. He only plays him as just a touch too enthusiastic
yeah.
about what he's doing.
Feel bad for him when he gets outsmarted, as he does in some cases, right? When he realizes, oh no, I've touched the cane that my rival doctor dropped to the ground, quote unquote, accidentally. He realizes that was on purpose.
Well, it's all the more angering because these guys who are outsmarting him are such boobs.
It's a very Ubermensch kind of thing. He's being brought down by these Untermenschen.
And the worst of all is, and I think it must have been written or directed to come off this way, is Van Breuken's completely unconvincing conviction that he just has to stop doing this because God. That he says over and over again. It's so, he's just such a Philistine. I was actually rooting at one point, I think that sequence is shot this way on purpose, rooting for him to kill Van Breuken. And the fact that he doesn't makes him seem like a saint. It rehumanizes him that he doesn't kill his lifelong friend.
A lifelong friend whom he has destroyed mentally and spiritually, right? And the diary mentions, you know, I'm older than Van Breuken. This is what he's writing in the 1880s, and so I can dominate him.
Yeah, he was vampirically preying even on this young man when he met him.
Yeah, but he does have some sentimentality, and he lets the old man alone. He never dies.
He even ends up, like, agreeing with him that this has to stop, and he has to break off his relationship with Helen.
Yeah, and Helen Walker doesn't agree.
Or what's her name? Eve. I thought that would become important at some point, that her name was Eve, that they would start a new race together, but...
She's not kept in the dark the whole way. He tells her what he's been doing. He doesn't directly admit to killing all these people, but she's heard about it now, that his fingerprints match the serial killer, and she's still willing to go to the continent with him, to meet up with this discredited surgeon in Paris.
Well, it's kind of an incipient Francis Ford Coppola Dracula plot, in that from the beginning, the way she talks about him, she talks about, like, when they're sitting in the garden, she talks about, like, she feels her way inside how it must be to be this man who's pushing these boundaries, right? And how she would like to be in his position, and she wants to learn enough science to help him in his experiments. So obviously she sees him as not just a romantic partner and not just a great man that she wants to help, but as someone that she would like to be.
She certainly believes herself to be a greater person than all of the twits that are around her at her house. She's eager to push on to whatever new realm Nils Asther is going to reveal to her. There's a great suspenseful sequence when the police show up after he's just talked about, well, I've got to get rid of the body of this kid that I have, you know, poisoned even before we got to the surgery day. He's dead. We don't know exactly what happened, right? And that could be where you might be worried, is it missing a reel? But it's by design.
Well, the kid breaks out of his room.
Reads the Vita Immortalis.
The journal, right? And he starts going crazy. Nils Asther is telling him, you're not prepared to know all of this. You're going to get overexcited. And Van Breuken, when he collapses, says that his heart's not going to be able to take this. Maybe there's a congenital weakness there.
Yeah, it must be, because it's not Nils Asther's intention, certainly, to kill this boy, at least before surgery.
Scaring him to death.
Yeah, that's part of it.
In addition to giving him bad drugs.
So he's dead, and Nils Asther claims that he's going to do something about it, and there's a nice transition there where you're not sure, has he done it yet or right. not? And the police show up at his door. It's our Scotland Yard inspector. He encounters Asther on the street. We don't know if Asther is getting ready to take the body away or he's coming back from doing it. And in fact, it's not exactly either of those, as we discover. But we go through the whole scene. The inspector comes in. He's leery of Asther. He wants to go second. He doesn't want to be ambushed. They have a long talk about the serial killer fingerprints. I really like that too, the discussion all the authorities have back at the lab, where the two choices are the fingerprint system is washed up, garbage, or magic exists. All of the police are like, well, no, the fingerprint system is accurate. So magic or crazy science does exist in our world. We're all going to accept that.
That's also why taking the portrait to Scotland Yard is so ridiculous, because they've already got the fingerprint proof. But they're talking about how an expert could tell whether this painting is by the same person, which everybody knows from all the documentaries and art forgeries by now that is not true. The fingerprint system is good enough. You don't need this further evidence.
Right, but maybe to convince a jury you do, right? Because the fingerprinting was still pretty early on in the 40s. So having that extra bit of proof probably would help with the case, but it's never going to go to trial, of course, as we know. So after this talk between the inspector and Carell, Asther, other police show up. They've found the cabman that brought the quasi-drowned student back to the mansion. So everyone knows the student was there. Asther's like, well, he left the next day. What, he hasn't shown up yet? They have a warrant, and Asther is very cavalier about that. He's like, oh, go ahead. All you're going to find is the old man upstairs asleep.
Hopefully he's hidden Vita Immortalis.
Well, they obviously didn't go through any books. Everyone leaves in a sulk because they find nothing. And then Asther just saunters back out to his car where the dead student is sitting in the passenger seat.
Yeah, he's done a weekend at Bernie's.
And now he's going to drive him and throw him in the river. Guess you were cheering along with that wholeheartedly. And I was maybe cheering along with it half-heartedly because I was getting more and more disturbed by Aster's behavior.
Well, I have to admit, because these people opposing him are portrayed as such boobs, and because Helen Walker, who's not a boob, is supporting him the entire time, and because the argument Van Breuken keeps making is not stop killing people, it's God says you must stop this. Just no, I've just come to the conviction. Nils Asther actually says to him at that point, your mind is decaying.
Yeah.
If the scientific conclusion you've come to at the end of your life is God says stop it, you know, God is the limit, you must not try to push beyond that. It's very easy to rationalize what he's doing and very difficult to feel the murders.
Yeah, and that's all by design. That's not an accident. That's how the movie wants you to feel, so that you're still invested in this man's lifelong quest and his real deep affection, love for Helen Walker.
But he also has to ultimately face that it's true that he is doing this for himself at this point. And he also faces, by the end, in their conversation in this train compartment, that this lifelong quest has made him completely lonely.
Sure, everyone he knew except for Van Broecken is dead. And Minerva, I guess. Their association did not last long.
Well, no one can last long with him or they're going to discover his secret. Which he was telling himself that he was eventually going to reveal to Eve. Van Broecken gets a good one in on him by saying, oh, you're going to reveal to your fiancé that you're a walking mummy.
That's one of the only times Van Broecken seems to have the upper hand, briefly. But then he goes back to ranting about God. The conservative moral of Frankenstein. We all know Frankenstein is a more multivalent tale than that. Otherwise, it wouldn't be so evocative and have lived so long in everyone's mind and in so many adaptations. But on the page, what Mary Shelley wrote is that Frankenstein is wrong and must be destroyed because he violated God's law for man. We don't believe that as we read the book. Never believe it if you're interested in scientific progress. And it is a difficult thing to judge, you know, where's that line? When have you gone too far in the pursuit of expanding humanity's horizons? Nils Asther clearly has gone too far.
Even by the laws of man, never mind God.
There is a great special effect as he ages before our eyes.
Right, and I like not something you usually see with the male gender. There's this deep, racking shame in him that he's going to be revealed as old and ugly. Although, still got a nice full head of hair.
Helen Walker's ready to stick with him till the very end, but he is not. He says, we have to part here, I'm sorry. Gives her the wedding ring that he had bought for her. But then he runs off, and he's 90, and he has a heart attack on the platform. And that's, sadly, the demise.
And Van Broecken has destroyed all their work, so no one can follow.
He burns it all up. So yeah, it's a dead end. That can't be a good thing. At least let scientists look at what they did without going and killing any more people. They could still read the accounts.
Van Broecken is being too fundamentalist again.
It's a terrible thing to do because then you're going to make the next mad scientist start it all over again at the beginning.
So yeah, I thought it was very well done in terms of how a writer and director and performers can play with audience sympathies.
And who is the writer? Because we don't know anything about this director.
Well, it was based on a play by someone by the name of, well, it's a pseudonym, a British playwright who called himself Barré Lyndon.
Yeah, I saw that. But who wrote the screenplay? Anyone that we know?
Well, Garrett Fort did the adaptation. Oh, okay, so he was a specialist, I guess, on horror films. Well, there you go. So he worked on Dracula, Frankenstein, Island of Lost Souls, Invisible Man, Dracula's Daughter, The wow. Devil Doll. So yeah, a specialist. So that makes sense because this is very well done. And the finished screenplay is attributed to Charles Kenyon.
Okay.
His credits include A Midsummer Night's Dream and The Petrified Forest.
Yeah, I've seen his name on Warner Brothers films, probably lots of other things.
Yeah, it seems like his career was going in a B-movie direction and then stopped not long after this, at least according to the partial filmography on his page.
Okay, well, not a bad way to go out for him either. Let's go back to John Douglas Eames and see what he had to say about Salty O'Rourke. A slick screenplay by Milton Holmes took Alan Ladd back to the kind of good-bad character that he played best. Salty O'Rourke was a gambler involved in a crooked scheme with a bribeable jockey. It blows up in his face, and he decides that the quieter life urged on him by his schoolteacher girlfriend is a better bet after all. No question about the box office fate of this one. Ladd's popularity was at its zenith, and the vigorous style of director Raoul Walsh, borrowed from Warner Brothers, made sure that the entertainment didn't flag. His cast in E.D. Leshen's production contained dependable players. William Demarest, Gail Russell, Bruce Cabot, Spring Byington, Daryl Hickman, Lester Matthews, Marjorie Woodworth. But the memorable performance came from 18-year-old Stanley Clements as a jockey who wouldn't cooperate on a fixed race and was murdered by the fixers.
I think that's right.
Well, some of the details there are not exactly right.
I mean, I think that last part is correct, that
Clements is great. Yeah.
Clements makes the movie. Alan Ladd's flinty persona is maybe a little too understated given that he doesn't have the central role here.
No, it's great. Perfect.
It might be great and perfect, but he's definitely not in danger of stealing the picture from anybody, as Stanley Clements is.
Alan! Exclamation point. Alan is great. Gail Russell is awesome in this movie. Very happy to see her, always. It's just a really strange mix of elements that come together, as so often is the case with Raoul Walsh. Walsh. He works his magic.
Again, he was not by any means the first choice of director, and of course he's at Warner Brothers.
Yeah, well, they borrowed him, so they obviously realized that he could bring something to it. If you've been listening for a long time, you might have heard our 1932 episode for Fox on Me and My Gal, where Fresh Bezok is often uttered by Spencer Tracy and Joan Bennett. Well, Bezok comes back here in this movie briefly.
Two fighting prostitutes.
Raoul Walsh loves this term.
I guess I've just given up on using sex worker when we're talking about movies. Occasionally, an older movie or one of the other films from other eras that we're looking at contains a character that I would tend to call a sex worker because of the way they're being treated by the movie, but mostly movies are presenting, unfortunately, prostitutes.
But she's his girlfriend. I mean, he brings her across the border briefly, and then he's like, okay, get out of here. I'm obsessed with this teacher now.
You can have a girlfriend who's a sex worker.
You can.
This guy certainly can. He's a little criminal.
He was a dead-end kid, right? Or
East End
kid. One of the later incarnations. He's not an original dead-end kid.
East Side kid and a Bowery boy.
Right.
And of course, he gives that generic flavor that they all have, but he acts with a lot of spirit. We also have to talk about the writer, Milton Holmes. This was an original screenplay by him, and he did a whole bunch of screenplays. Well, not a whole bunch, but several screenplays in this vein.
Oh, he did Mr. Lucky. That is a very similar kind of movie.
And Johnny O'Clock.
Oh, I love that one too.
Boots Malone, Mr. Soft Touch.
Yeah, every single one of those are about a good bad man.
Yeah, there you go. He had his formula. So he is a strong auteur presence in this film. You questioned whether Gail Russell's car accident was as bad as Helen Walker's. Well, let me read it to you under the legal troubles section of her Wikipedia page. In February 1955, she hit another car containing a couple and their baby while driving. The couple later sued her for $30,000.
Of course, anyone that drives drunk and kills or maims people...
or just scares them.
What I'm talking about, though, is the cause of her alcoholism is better documented and more just pitiable. She just turned to alcohol as like a teenager because she couldn't deal with being stared at.
Okay, so you feel that that's sadder than Helen Walker's alcoholism, which we don't know the source for.
That's what I'm saying. We don't know. I'm sure there's a pitiable cause for it as well.
Well, what's so sad is that Gail Russell, who does not enchant me nearly as much as she does you, though she has very nice eyes.
She's so beautiful.
She is so beautiful, but her acting does not enchant me. I mean, she's very, very young when she starts making films, and then she dies so young. So yeah. It's very tragic.
It is. And she gets off to such a great start, too. Like, The Uninvited is such a great showcase for her. Probably the best movie she ever made is Moonrise, an immortal performance. She's just got a really nice comedy sense and vulnerability, but also able to lay down the law with people. Casting her as a teacher is perfect.
Okay.
I thought she was terrific in this role, and as well.
She's just like the antithesis of magnetism to me, but okay.
Wow. I love the kinds of things that Alan Ladd gets to do in this movie too, right? Because he's this tough gambler. The inciting cause for all of the tribulations that these people go through in the film happens days before we meet them. There's no flashback to it or anything. Alan Ladd had some kind of a partner in gambling or crime or whatever who took $20,000 from a bigger gangster, Bruce Cabot, and now the partner's dead and Alan Ladd is holding the bag and owes the money. And if he doesn't pay it, he's going to be knocked off. He negotiates for himself a 30-day reprieve and he's got to work his magic, cash in some cufflinks for $1,000 and turn that into $20,000 somehow. The only way to do that is to win it big at the races.
So this is very much a male melodrama.
Yeah.
In which it almost reminded me, and I guess this is a common structure for movies that involve juveniles. Gail Russell is barely older in this movie than the actor who is playing Johnny, who is, I think, 19, playing a 21-year-old who's pretending to be a 17-year-old.
Yeah.
It reminded me of a Jerry Lewis movie a little bit, in that you get this juvenile character who's outside of the realm of the movie's romantic possibilities, gazing wistfully upon them and can often be placed in a victimized light. But this movie goes way further than that. This is like if in a Martin and Lewis movie, Lewis not only didn't get his own girl at the end, but died.
That never happens in a Jerry Lewis movie.
No, but if you want to know what that would be like, watch this movie. That was quite unexpected. But yeah, so the male melodrama aspect is, the soapy aspect is really played up to the point of this character sacrificing himself at the behest of Gail Russell and being killed.
Yeah, I mean, her plea at the end, she doesn't carry a gun, she doesn't believe in it, but she pretty much put that gun right up to Clement's head and ensured that he was going to get blown away by the gangsters.
He's like a Jimmy Cagney character who has to redeem himself through love, except that he doesn't seem to have done anything awful enough. He's just kind of a brat.
Well, he's rude in class.
He's a harasser.
And he's a double crosser. Now, he feels like he has his reasons, and the movie is pretty good about...
Well, Alan Ladd is using him.
He sure is.
And manipulating him romantically.
He's manipulating everyone.
Yeah, so he really is a Dean Martin type.
Again, the movie puts you on his side because you know he's got to scheme something up quickly or else he's going to be murdered.
Well, yes, much like the man in Half Moon Street. What's he going to do?
What he comes up with is, okay, there's this amazing horse that we know of, owned by someone else. The only thing holding this horse back is that it tries to kill everyone that gets near it, but if someone could ride him, he would win this big sweepstakes that's coming up. They know of one jockey who's like the horse whisperer who can do it, but he's been barred by the racing commission, presumably for doing the kind of shit that we see him do in this movie, entertaining bribes and talking his fellow jockeys into throwing a race in a nice way. So he's down in Mexico. Alan Ladd and William Demarest, the sidekick in this movie, I mean, a Paramount stalwart at this point. He's in all the Preston Sturges movies. Here he's kind of playing a similar role to that, only he doesn't have Preston Sturges level dialogue to deliver. They go down and get this guy, and they're like, we got a horse for you to ride. We figured out a way for you to get back into the sport. All you have to do, you've got a younger brother, right? 17-year-old brother back in New York. No one's gonna know that's not you, so just write to him, get your birth certificate, and we'll take care of the rest. The racing commission swallows all of this whole, but because they believe he's 17, they've got regulations to enforce, and that means that this young jockey now has to go to jockey school.
And that is how Gail Russell is shoehorned in. Patriarchy alert, both of these movies are of the highly common 95% of all movies type, where there is essentially only one female character in a world of men.
Well, except there's Spring Byington in this one too.
That's true. She is a lot of fun, actually. That's true. She is another substantial female character. The movie's doing slightly better than Half Moon Street.
Without Spring Byington, I mean, half of Alan Ladd's performance wouldn't be there, because so much of what's great about him in this movie is the way he goes to work on charming the family, right? And mother in particular.
Yes, very easily. So he's just playing this character like a dead-eyed psychopath.
Sort of like this gun for hire.
Yeah, just like he usually does. Although the subtle variation on that in that Loretta Young movie.
And Now Tomorrow.
Yeah, worked wonders. Just a subtle shift in his level of indifference.
Yeah, as much as I love this movie, it's not quite as immortal as And Now Tomorrow, but yeah, both of these have been great for me. And he has this friendship with William Demarest, which is rock solid. So there's some basis there. He has real feelings, at least for him.
We also know from their conversation in his car after their night out arranged by her mother, one of the places where we find out a little more about where he's coming from, but also his conversations with William Demarest. Anyway, he says that he doesn't believe that Gail Russell could ever possibly be interested in him. It doesn't even occur to him, despite the fact that he's buying dresses for her and they're going out on dates.
And she's clearly in love with him. She's pretty transparent about it. But yeah, he's got his worldview and he doesn't think that this could ever lead anywhere. He could charm her for a little while, possibly, right? And get her to take the jockey under her wing the way he wants her to. And he appeals to her teacherly instinct.
It is the Henry James plot, where she is being manipulated into manipulating this little, tiny little jockey victim.
Really got a lot of complex levels to it. magnificently performed. I like Bruce Cabot in this movie too. Do you remember him? One of our most distinctive moments as a podcast, I would say, is when we watched Flame of New Orleans and described it as a great Bruce Cabot film, which was a left-handed put-down of Marlene Dietrich, who really shouldn't have bothered to make that movie. I'm more familiar with him playing this kind of role, where he's just smirking off to the side and hating the leading man.
By the way, this was supposed to be a vehicle when Milton Holmes originally wrote the story for Clark Gable, Rosalind Russell, and Mickey Rooney. Can you imagine? Can you imagine Mickey Rooney pining for Rosalind Russell?
That doesn't work. I can imagine him pining for Gail Russell, but he's too old by this point. I mean, if it was 1940...
Oh, no, this was earlier, I think.
Yeah, those are MGM players.
Yeah, so maybe this screenplay had been sitting around for a while.
A long time, I would say, based on that, maybe 10 years.
So Paramount purchased the rights, the film rights to the story in 1942 and developed it as a vehicle for George Raft. It really does seem like Alan Ladd is inheriting the George Raft acting school mantle.
Funny you should say that, because The Glass Key, the character played by George Raft in 1935, is reprised by Alan Ladd in 1942.
George Raft, of course, he is normally... his blankness has a completely different quality. You believe that George Raft just has certain limitations as an actor in his expressiveness, although within those limits, he can be very effective. He can be even very moving. But with Alan Ladd, you feel like this is a put-on. And of course, with the performances he gives later, like in Shane, you realize that it was a put-on.
As much as I love George Raft, I will agree that Alan Ladd is even greater.
And of course, as soon as he found this weird, blank, psychopathic character, that's when he became a huge star.
Yeah.
I don't know who was responding to this. Men? Women? Both? I don't know.
People loved his pairing with Veronica Lake.
Right. Who is also weirdly indifferent.
And I love them. So I'm a man responding to it. I don't know. We're going to be doing, I think, in 1946, The Blue Dahlia. So that'll be our first Ladd Lake movie for the podcast.
I tried watching those movies and whatever mood I was in at the time decades ago, it was not that mood, but we're going to be trying them again.
We'll get you into that mood.
Soften me up with Salty O'Rourke and Now Tomorrow.
And Now Tomorrow.
That's my favorite so far. It had that snappy Raymond Chandler dialogue.
Blue Dahlia is also written by Raymond Chandler.
Yeah, but it's nice to have that in a weird context, like a woman's picture.
Yeah, it was. The schemes and counter schemes going on, you're quite right to put it in the realm of Henry James. So much emotional manipulation going on. It sneaks up on you.
And it's all for, as we say, the indisputably relatable, well, not relatable, but sympathetic purpose of Alan Ladd trying not to die, just like Kate Croy has her father to look after. You're right. There's something understandable behind all of this manipulation.
Yeah, he's not doing it for kicks. I love the scene where they're in the car when Gail Russell first notices that he has a gun, and he's like, well, you know, that's my friend Roscoe.
He says, I can persuade my friends, but Roscoe persuades my enemies.
Yeah, and we see he's pretty handy with it.
And even without it.
He's got a good quick draw. Bruce Cabot shows up and interrupts his dinner with Gail Russell. He doesn't have to shoot anyone there. But yeah, it does come down to at the end. Wasn't sure exactly how much bloodshed we were going to get in this movie. If it was going to stay on the level of underworld adjacent comedy with only the slight threat of violence. But no, we get full on murder and revenge murder at the end of this movie.
Well, I guess with Alan Ladd cast, they couldn't disappoint his fans. I guess the reason, well, partly it is for his romantic redemption, although as I said, he's just a kid and doesn't seem to need this much redemption.
No, it's just for pathos.
Well, but it also motivates Alan Ladd's character to be a good man. The realization that this life has been destroyed partly by him.
I mean, if only he had come up with some kind of different scheme to get those $20,000. Poor little Johnny would have just been living it up in Mexico.
You were telling me Alan Ladd was 5'4"? Apparently, according to the army, he was 5'7".
There's a lot of debate about how short Alan Ladd was.
No one says 5'4".
He does tower over the jockey, which is unusual in an Alan Ladd film. When you see him standing next to William Bendix, it's a different story.
It's weird, all of these actors who get famous playing, you know, children and juveniles then grow up to be short. It's like they've somehow willed themselves short.
You're talking about Clements?
Yeah, but also I guess often it's a case of hiring someone who's slightly older to play someone slightly younger, in which case they have to look slightly younger, etc.
Did you notice that Lionel from the Human Comedy is in this movie?
I did not.
And of course, even more famously in Leave Her to Heaven, Drowning to Death. He's in this movie as one of the other jockeys.
Okay, that makes sense.
Daryl Hickman? He's got a pretty small role compared to what he's going to have in Leave Her to Heaven, which is the same year. And I think we're covering it in a couple of weeks.
But that's just another juvenile bound to die. A pathetic death.
Yeah, that's pretty sad. In this one, nothing terrible happens to him. He just participates in throwing a race, which is, that scene is crazy. He gets all the kids together out on the baseball field, and he's like, we all love Gail Russell, don't we? And they all do. It's a bunch of teenage boys who are obsessed with their teacher.
But none of them talk to her the way that this guy does.
No. But he convinces them, you know, she's coming to the race on Friday, and I'm riding a nag that can't win. Just to give her a thrill, why don't you give me a little head start at the beginning? Nothing crooked. They win. I mean, this race doesn't have a big purse or anything, and there's no big-time gangsters involved in it, but we already see he's willing to play fast and loose with the Racing Association's laws, and this is how he got in trouble in the first place.
Well, but he convinces them by saying that she needs a new dress.
They're all gonna benefit from seeing that. They bought her a ticket on it and give it to her as a present, and she's like, oh, isn't that sweet?
To use it for the athletic fund.
Alan Ladd has to intervene again with his manipulative ways, and he's like, well, if she does that, we're all going to be barred again from racing, so I have to convince her that she needs to accept this present of the dress. And he makes sure that she does by going along with her and buying her an even better one.
So his main goal in thrusting these two together is just to keep Johnny motivated and on the straight and narrow. But yep. Every time Johnny is rejected by Gail Russell or he sees the two of them together, he goes on another bender.
Yep.
Or does something stupid.
It's a good idea, but Johnny's a little bit too suspicious for it to work out all that well, and it really threatens to go completely haywire at the end because Johnny decides he's going to look up Bruce Cabot and throw the race, knowing that this is going to ensure that Alan Ladd gets killed, and he's going to be taking a loss on it because if he just wins the race, he gets $16,000, and from the gangsters, he's getting $10,000.
Well, see, he's capable of being a very, just like Alan Ladd, he's capable of being a very bad man.
Yes.
But he is inspired by his love to sacrifice himself.
There are several layers to the final movement of this tragedy because William Demarest goes to Gail Russell and pleads the case for Alan Ladd's life. And then she goes to Johnny and does the same thing. Even at the time, I think it's a moving scene, what she does. But when you realize that what it's going to mean for Johnny, once you know that he's going to get actually killed for this, really lingers in the memory as quite an unexpectedly affecting film.
Of course, it's hard to know what caused this kid to go so steeply downhill anyway. Was it just that he was this crazy jockey prodigy?
Yeah, he's so good. I mean, he's the best jockey that has ever been. And they're trying to figure out what's his secret. He's like, I just talk to the horse. Nobody else can do it. When Alan Ladd begins to suspect that they can't control this guy, they try to bring in another competent jockey, and Alan Ladd mentions to him, just talk to the horse.
So he's obviously never had an ideal and just has nothing to live for at the beginning of this movie. And then at the end of it, he has something to die for.
Well, that's a tried and true formula for great melodrama.
It's unexpected with such a young character, but I guess that's, I don't know, I'm not familiar with the Dead End Kid and the East Side Kid and all of these kid working class or criminal class kid movies. But I guess the idea is that they are always walking on that border of darkness.
Sure, but I don't think that those movies usually involve a tragic murder. You know, they just sass each other and get into scuffles.
It's an odd thing to see a character this decadent and disillusioned at such a young age.
Well, that part of it, I agreed. That comes out of the Dead End Kids matrix. Those kids are
nihilistic? Is that the word I'm looking for?
Yeah, pretty much, right?
But when we see him with the horse, he is this kind of genius genius prodigy. With the horse, he's completely in his element. He's happy, and he's doing the thing he was born to do, but once he's off the horse, everything goes wrong.
Yeah, he doesn't have the skills required to succeed in any other avenue of life. And I'm sure it hasn't helped that he hasn't been able to ride a horse in a long time. That's only been helping to degenerate his sense of public-spiritedness or social skills. I don't know. When I was watching it, I was wondering, is Alan Ladd gonna have to sacrifice his life in order for others to go on or something like that? But knowing that this author, which I didn't know, wrote all those other movies that you mentioned, I mean, they all have that in common, that they're happy ending movies that kind of surprise you, because character this much on the wrong side of the good-bad divide usually dies in Hollywood movies. Maybe dies in a kind of redeeming way, but not in this guy's screenplays. He always gets the girl at the end and reforms.
Well, it's a new era. Noir-influenced era, because it's a code era, so it shouldn't be this way, but again, resonant with our viewing of Killers of the Flower Moon. Somebody actually has to die for Alan Ladd to wake up morally and emotionally.
Sadly for Johnny, he's elected.
Well, actually, a lot of people have to die for Leonardo DiCaprio's character to wake up. What am I talking about?
And several people do wind up dying in the fallout of Salty O'Rourke, too, or at least two more gangsters, but we don't care about them.
No, that's the fun part.
Just a good action scene, Alan Ladd, weaponless, goes into the lion's den and defeats them all.
I don't know about you, but I did feel like Gail Russell was right, and that if he got in there with his gun, he would have gotten himself killed.
Well, she's absolutely right. He got frisked. He wouldn't have been able to bring the gun in anyway, so no, I don't know what he was true. Thinking about.
That's true. Doesn't really make a difference.
Next week on the podcast, we return to Lily Palmer, the actress d'oeuvre-vue. Part 5 is going to be The Rake's Progress and Beware of Pity. These are the last two films that she made in the UK, I believe, before heading at least temporarily to Hollywood. So we'll see you then.